Okay, good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the categorical course on tumor imaging. We are switching to the colorectal section, and I just wanted to go over the schedule with you. So we have four lectures lined up for this afternoon, and they are as listed in the program. Tomorrow from 7:30 to 9:30, we have additional lectures. I just wanted to alert you that Dr. Mukesh Harrison-Ghani will not be here. So Dr. Zara Kassam will be giving his talk for him, just to let you know. Okay, so let's get started. And our first lecturer is Dr. Abe Dachman. He is a well-known expert in CT colonography. And he's going to start off by presenting preparing patients for CT colonography. Abe?
Thank you very much, Judy. I'm just going to move the mic a little bit further away. Maybe we'll have a little less reverberation. And thanks to my fellow, Joelle Wazen, who's here and helped with writing the manuscript in this presentation. I have no particular disclosures, some acknowledgments. And our CME objectives for this lecture is to understand how to cleanse the colon and use oral contrast, tag residual stool and fluid, and a little bit to understand how a CTC is performed, how the technologist who is really trained by you to perform colonic insufflation and scanning parameters, so they will turn to you to figure out how to do this. So, the important background is first to understand the importance of a clean and a well-distended colon and tagging with oral contrast. So the first point is excessive stool will hinder interpretation of CT colonography. And if you have untagged fluid, even though a soft polyp is a soft tissue density, at the low radiation dose that we use, you really can't see a polyp at all in untagged fluid. So those first two bullet points are patient-related factors in the prep. And the next two points are more tech-related factors, how you do the exam. Collapsed segments can hide lesions. And suboptimal distension, even if the exam may be interpretable, it will hinder interpretation and may make the exam too tedious to read or completely not readable. So here's an example of a well-prepared colon that actually has multiple polyp candidates, all of which turned out to be polyps in the patient who was a polyp maker. And, you know, not having stool and knowing you have a clean colon really helps over there. And here you have two movies, one on the left of a very clean colon, one on the right of a colon that's a little less clean and the tagging isn't as good. And you could see that the clean colon is just so much easier to interpret and to read than the colon that's not as clean. That's a little bit different than this kind of case where you have a lot of excessive untagged retained stool. Now, you can recognize that that stool on 2D, it has bubbles of gas within it, and you may be able to problem solve, but there are just too many polyp candidates to make the case readable on a primary 3D read. So you'd have to read the case in a very tedious 2D read. Or you might have a lot of stool. This is both a combination of bubbly liquid stool that's attached to the wall, as well as, you know, balls of stool that are seen around. That just makes the exam too time consuming to read and basically not readable. So very important to understand why we're doing this lecture and why we need to prep our patients well. And here's an example of a supine and a prone scan. There is fluid. The fluid is tagged, and there is a polyp. You can see on the supine view, having contrast tag the fluid allows you to see the polyp and allows the subtraction software to show the polyp well in 3D. And also, there's a little bit of tagging on the surface of a polyp that actually also helps you pick up lesions. Here is an example where you have untagged fluid. That untagged fluid is going to completely hide a fairly large lesion. You can see on this supine view, there's a fluid level, and the 3D view doesn't help you. 3D view is not going to solve that problem. And if you look at the opposite view, here a prone view, you can see the air fluid level on the ventral surface. You see a fairly large pedunculated polyp becomes visible because it's not hidden by the untagged fluid. And here we have a software program that sort of cuts the colon and lays it open flat. Here you can see that there's tagging and the software allows the subtraction of that fluid. You could see the subtraction on the 2D and the subtraction then on the 3D. And here just a freeze frame to show you that sometimes you want to turn the tagging, the subtraction on, and sometimes you want to turn it off. So here we're comparing off and on, just to show you as the features that I showed you before, sometimes you want to be able to see it without the fluid, sometimes you want to see the fluid to see if there's something in there, maybe switch it to a bone window to see if you can see anything within the fluid. And several examples of some work by Kim and colleagues that show that more difficult flat lesions can sometimes be detected because of tagging. It's sometimes hard to see that there's a little soft tissue component underneath the tagging, but here again, as in this view with a supine and a decubitus view, serrated polyps and villous tumors, possibly because of their irregular surface features, might attract tagging, particularly some people think barium, more so than water-soluble agents, but I've seen with water-soluble agents tagging work as well for flat lesions. Now, when you have an area that is collapsed, if you have a center line, even if it's not optimal, and you can fly through, the case is still readable. But here you see one segment that's collapsed. So how big does that segment have to be to make it unreadable? Well, if it's collapsed, it can really hide a large lesion. So here you see a circumferential mass, essentially, and it's completely hidden, just showing you the same image but on soft tissue, and a lung window, just to show you that the window alone doesn't really help you find a lesion in a segment that's collapsed. So you may have to qualify that. Well, fine, if it's the rectosigmoid, rectum, or the sigmoid, maybe you could just see that with a flexible sigmoidoscope or something. But, you know, if you have segments that are collapsed, you're going to have to do a colonoscopy or repeat the exam. So the message to you is that in virtual colonoscopy, what is heaven? Heaven is a clean and a well-distended colon. Right? Reminds me of Barry Menemadez, as he used to say, heaven is a clean colon. Okay, so the overview of the steps in colon preparation, now that we understand the importance, is firstly diet modification. Typically, we do a one-day prep. Now, I cannot remember the last time I had to cancel a case or bring a patient back because of retained stool. And part of that is we have an intake program where we have a questionnaire for the patient, and we know if that patient is getting a virtual colon because they had failed colonoscopy due to retained stool, or they have chronic constipation and history of failed exams, then we might switch to a two-day prep. So we're very careful about that, and you tell the patient, if you're having formed stool on the day of your exam, give me a call. Don't necessarily come in. So I can't recall a case where I had to just come in, patient came in prepped, and I had to cancel or bring the patient back. Choosing a cathartic. You can have a hyperosmotic electrolyte solution or some sort of saline cathartic, and then you have to choose your tagging agent. So first on diet modification, patients can see this in information sheets that you prepare and send them. They can see this on the web. Low residue diet, clear liquid diet, and stay hydrated for 1 or 2 days before. Some tips for success. Now this is a point, I don't know, it might be covered later in some of the lectures later on, but you know, one of the economic successes of virtual colonoscopy is when you offer a classic screening patient the option of a same-day read. And if you have the small percentage of patients that actually have a large polyp and need a colonoscopy, you might be able to offer it to them on the same day. If you're an institution or you're trying to set up a program that does that, just be aware that your prep instructions now have to follow OC, which stands for optical colonoscopy, guidelines. That means, you know, patients may have to be off blood thinners, maybe they can't have colored foods that will stain the mucosa, you know, red dye and things like that. And, of course, ask about failed colonoscopy, as I pointed out, due to poor prep or severe constipation. And then, you know, patients can have information sheets to understand how to avoid a high-fiber diet and focus on a low-fiber diet while they're still eating the day or two or three before. The longer they're on a low-fiber diet, the better. Now, the categories of cathartics, which we alluded to, first would be a polyethylene glycol prep, which can vary between 2 and 4 liters. It minimizes the amount of stool, but it leaves a relatively wet colon, which, if not tagged, can certainly hide lesions. It's very safe, so it's safe for patients with renal or cardiac issues. And one way to do this is to use a polyethylene glycol prep and not have to worry about a saline cathartic if you're not really screening or asking those questions to the patients. Well, saline cathartic prep, such as phosphosoda, mag citrate is the one commonly used in the programs, would leave more residual stool, but will give a drier colon with less residual fluid. So saline cathartics and laxatives, there are a lot of different ways to skin the cat. I don't want to show you too many to confuse you, just show you a few examples and a few programs that some people use. So you could just see some choices, but not too many that confuse you. One is a split dose when you use saline cathartics. Some people like giving half of the dose the day prior, half of the dose the morning of the exam. It can leave some excessive fluid. But if you add bisacodyl, if bisacodyl orally takes a little time to work, you have to give it the day before, that'll help clean out that residual fluid. Bunch of brand names, but bottom line is you have a lot of choices. A lot of choices out there. So tagging agents. Well, you can use hyperosmotic agents, such as diatrizoe, and you can use isoosmotics, such as iohexol, or you could use barium agents, and or a combination thereof. And barium agents can come in the form of your regular CT barium, or some companies make a small volume of 40% weight volume barium that you could give patients for tagging. And some people like to combine some of these, for example, the barium with diatrizoate or the barium with iohexol. I will say that it's so rare to find a contrast allergic reaction due to oral iodinated agents, but medical legally, I just don't want to go there. If this patient is the kind of patient that you would want to give a steroid prep before you gave IV contrast, then I just take the approach, I'm going to use barium for them. Here's a sample CTC polyethylene glycol prep using diatrizoate and barium. So this is a common one. If you had to pick one, I think this is a really nice one. No solid food all day, clear liquid, stay hydrated. In the afternoon, 3 to 5, you take your bottle of over-the-counter powdered PEG diluted in water. In the evening, 250cc bottle of 2% barium at bedtime, and 60cc diatrizoate and an additional dose of diatrizoate before the 2 to 3 hours before the exam. Now remember, diatrizoate is hyperosmotic, so it actually gives a little kick to the prep as well. It helps clean out any little bit of residual. The other point I just want to make here is the reason I like the idea of a powdered polyethylene glycol prep is it doesn't require a prescription. You could use one of these agents that are available over the counter for constipation, tell the patient exactly how much to take, the whole bottle, and mix it, and how much liquid you want to mix it. So we tell our patients to use one of these over-the-counter powdered versions that are meant for constipation, but use the whole bottle and mix it with 1 to 2 liters of water. Here's a sample prep using saline cathartic. Again, no need to read every single part here to you. You can read it, but basically notice that at noon you're repeating the 2 teaspoons of iohexol, giving magnesium citrate in the evening. Notice that you're generally starting the prep sometime in the orlies and sometime in the afternoon so the patients can still go to work in the morning, and then around 7 p.m. repeat 2 teaspoons of iohexol and some bisacodyl tablets. Again, the day of the exam, have a little iohexol. Doesn't matter if you drink it straight. People like to put it in water just for taste. And some work that was published by Zales. These images are not from this publication, but this publication was a nice clinical evaluation publication. And he compared a full cathartic with tagging, a reduced cathartic with tagging, and basically no cathartic, right? So everybody who calls and asks you about this, can you do this without a prep, doc? I mean, the thing I hate most about colonoscopy is the prep. And so the answer is, it's theoretically possible. They had good results. Increasing patient comfort by going towards reduced prep or no cathartic. On the other hand, increasing ease of interpretation if you have a full cathartic prep, and also electronic subtraction doesn't work as well for solid tag stool. It works well for liquid. And so this is, I'm not going to read this to you, but this is just basically the way he did this prep comparison in these various categories. Okay, now we're going to turn to the next, second part of the talk, which is the steps for insufflation, teaching the techs how to scan and what to do. So let's just go overview of what we're going to talk about. You're going to teach your tech the following steps: insufflate and decide when to scout the patient. Do a quality assurance of that scout and decide what else do you need to do. Do you need to give more gas or not? Decide when to scan the patient. We teach our patients to do a little deflation maneuver then. Just disconnect the tubing from the machine that does the insufflation for about 3 seconds. You count 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, and the patient's comfort level really improves. And then quality assure the scan, turn them to cube. And I've shown you images, supine and prone, but now our preference is to do a supine and to cubitus view with the patient right side down to cubitus, because the sigmoid colon is the most problem area for distension, and that way it's the non-dependent surface. And then it just takes about a minute or less to re-insufflate the colon, repeat the scout and scan again, and do your QA. So here's the scanning protocol that your techs can use. I'll just highlight some things. Whatever you choose, you want to choose something within these parameters. You want to use a short breath hold, less than 10 seconds, to minimize motion artifact. We do our scans at about 15 MAS. We will increase that for obese patients. And you know that when you're in that range, it's been shown that as little as 10 MAS can be done on non-obese patients, and the radiation dose is terribly low, less than background radiation in the U.S. Be careful to include the entire colon in the scan field of view, and you might need to use a biplane scout for obese patients to make sure that you don't cut off the transverse colon. You know, maybe one way of doing this rather than reading this slide is I like to sort of say, well, what would you say if somebody doesn't know much about virtual colonoscopy, a patient calls you up and says, hey, doc, what's going to happen? So I would use sort of this description. Well, you're going to have to, we go through the cleansing, you're going to have to take something to cleanse your colon, some contrast to tag, but when you get there, we're going to put a small tube in your rectum, use a mechanical insufflator to inflate your colon, takes about a minute or two, so you feel a little crampy discomfort. We'll do a scan. It takes about 10 seconds. It takes about a minute to program the computer. You hold your breath for about 10 seconds. We scan you. Then we relieve the pressure, make you a little more comfortable, turn you on your side, and repeat the same thing. A scan, a scout. And then the computer reconstructs a picture of the colon as though you're looking at it from the inside. And we'll report any polyps. And we talk about the size. And we just mentioned that if there's anything outside the colon, we'll show it to you. So the patients are very comfortable at the end of the exam, and the perforation risk is extremely low. So what the tech needs to understand, that what you want to teach, is that there's this balance between maximizing distension to get a really perfect study and patient comfort and risk of perforation, even though that risk of perforation is low. So you can use any kind of insufflator. You know, when I started this, I used a pump that was used for dialysis before they made commercially available pumps. So anything that you could use to adjust the flow and attached to carbon dioxide would be great. Carbon dioxide is preferred over room air. Mechanical is preferred over manual insufflation. But we use a setup like this with CO2, this thin tubing. You can see that it has a catch for any fluid that comes out of the patient and a filter, so there's no bacteria that gets back into the machine. This particular company now has a digital version rather than the old analog version. And can you use other tubes? Absolutely. If my machine exploded, if I ran out of supplies, I would never tell a patient who's prepped and came to go back home. You can just use so many different things. You could just use a Foley catheter with a blue puffer and use room air insufflation if you had to. So there's the optimal way to do it, but recognize there are a lot of different ways that you can do it. Important to tell the patient to squeeze down and hold the gas in. The tube balloon is only really designed to prevent the tube from sort of slipping out. Certainly, we would not do a virtual colonoscopy if the patient had any risk of perforation. So if there's gross bleeding that's not related to hemorrhoids, acute abdominal pain, any signs of peritonitis. I mentioned the idea of doing a colonoscopy on the same day after a virtual that's abnormal, but also we have failed colonoscopies and requests from the clinicians to do a virtual colon after a failed optical. There's some controversy about that. I like to ask if you've done a biopsy. Doing a simple superficial biopsy would not increase the risk of perforation because large snare can't get through a standard scope. But, you know, they can do what's called a well biopsy, biopsying the same site multiple times, or a snare biopsy. And in those cases, you could damage the wall and risk perforation. I would just say that let the colon just heal if there have been biopsies. And, you know, I would not wait a week. The scar is weakest at about 7-8 days. I would like to wait a little bit longer. And rare vasovagal reactions, nausea, vomiting. Persistent pain, not seen it since I used room air. I haven't seen it with the use of carbon dioxide. If you do a virtual colon after an optical, certainly make sure that there is no free air, even if the patient isn't asymptomatic. You could do a very limited CT, very low dose, or an upright or a decubitus abdomen to make sure there's no free air so you don't get blamed for perforating somebody. Certainly watch out for hernias. Another situation that's been a problem if somebody might have a hernia. It's not an absolute contraindication, but just be careful, and I wouldn't allow the patient to get into high pain if they have, let's say, an incisional hernia or an inguinal hernia. If there's an obstructing cancer, you definitely can try to do a virtual colon, and it's helpful for looking for synchronous lesions. I've had very rare cases where a cancer has been completely obstructive and had a failed colonoscopy. It's happened to me in my entire career, I think, 2 or 3 times. So here's the mechanical insufflator setup, the catch that we talked about to get fluid. We usually adjust it's adjustable pressure between 0 and 25. And we like to start maybe adjusting the pressure around 17 for patient comfort. Usually it takes about a minute or two to insufflate the colon. My techs stopped doing this rotation maneuver. We just basically, when the patient has mild to moderate pain or about 2 liters have gone in, is their clue to scout. That's their end point, to scout the patient. And I always tell them, when you're in doubt, just scout. Rarely, if there's extreme pain, do the deflation maneuver for 3 seconds. If you think it's really spasm, you could consider giving glucagon. Haven't done that in quite a long time. We emphasize the biplane scout for obese patients, assess for underdistension, and again, we prefer the decubitus view rather than the prone view. The side that is non-dependent will be the least well-distended section. So here's in the scout where you have suboptimal distension. Here's a scout where you have not only great distension, but reflux into the small bowel. And a severely underdistended colon, if you have maximal pressure and you still can't do it, you can try to push additional air in or CO2 in a variety of ways, as well as, again, the option of changing to room air. With manual insufflation, all you really need to do is not take it out of the patient, but cut the tubing, put on a blue puffer, and puff room air in, usually around 60 puffs. Teach the techs to use about a finger breath above the top point of the colon, about a finger breath below the rectum, so they make sure they don't cut anything out of the field of view. Assess the scan and preview to make sure there's no excessive fluid or under distension. And again, routinely we do the right side down the cube next. The last thing I want to show you is a maneuver that we use for pushing in additional CO2 without disconnecting the tubing, and that is we use that fluid catch as though it were a puffer. And so what we do is if the patient's colon on the scout is still underdistended, just crimp the tubing on the pump side and squeeze the bag, and then the gas will go into the colon. And then transfer the bag to your other hand and crimp the tubing on the patient's side so the gas doesn't come out of the patient. And then let go on the pump side and wait for the bag to fill up again and the pressure to go up. And then you could just repeat the whole thing. So there's a little movie of me doing that, an old movie I made, pinching the tubing, squeezing the bag, and pushing the CO2 into the patient. And then when the bag is completely compressed, just switching to the other hand so I could free my other hand up to crimp the tubing on the patient's side, and then waiting for the bag to insufflate and then the pressure to go up above 25 so the gas won't come out of the patient. And that's basically one cycle. And my techs tend to use this actually quite frequently to get good distension. Then prepare to do the decubitus view. Some people put a pillow under the chest or pelvis. That's sort of optional. And just check the scout and then scan. So when you finish the exam, don't rush to pull the tube out of the patient. All you have to do is disconnect it from the pump, drop it to the floor, let the gas come out of the patient, let the patient turn prone and remove the pillows, and the pressure will help the gas come out of the colon, and that's the exam. And then you QA it for coverage, extracolonic findings, any asymptomatic pneumatosis, which is pretty rare and not a problem. Decide if you need any additional views, and check that the patient's comfortable. So I think we've covered all these points. Understand how to cleanse the colon and tag. Understand how CTC is performed, insufflation, and scanning parameters. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay. I think we'll take some Q&A right now. So a couple of questions. There's some, I'm going to wait for some to come through because this is hybrid, so we'll have some virtual questions come through. But do you routinely insufflate the rectal balloon? And if you do, do you deflate it in at least one position so that you don't obscure rectal lesions?
Right, so that is one of the ways of doing it. We routinely do inflate the balloon because the balloon is very small on the tubing that I showed you. And if you keep it in the rectal vault, just have the tech push it a little bit into the rectal vault, it won't be right up against the anal verge. You want it up against the anal verge when you turn the patient so that it doesn't slip out. But when you do the scan, you can either deflate it or you could just push it in a few centimeters so it's not right up the anal verge, and you'll still be able to see hemorrhoids and anal papilla and things like that.
Okay. And do you actually perform laxative-free CT colonography at your site?
We do not.
Okay.
We do not. So people do not routinely. That it, I thought I wanted to make that clear that it works in research. And so some people have said if you have a very frail patient and the choice is do a laxative free or do nothing because there'll be no other choice for them other than DNA testing and things like that, that might be a case to use it, but we have not used it.
Okay. I don't think I know of any site currently in this country that performs the laxative free option.
Right.
Yeah.
I see one other question popping up.
There's a question that came in about same-day tagging protocol for failed colonoscopy. What's your protocol?
Right. So I'm going to expand that question to another scenario. What if the patient came in and said, oh, doc, I forgot to take my tagging. I forgot to take my oral contrast. You give the patient the oral contrast, the whole dose, right there on the spot, and wait, depending if they're able, 2 hours, 1.5 will usually do it, 1.5 to 2 hours for the contrast to reach the colon, and you'll usually have successful tagging.
But you're giving the water-soluble?
Whichever you choose, right, we use water-soluble, correct. So we personally use iohexol, bottle, 50 cc bottle of iohexol.
I think, you know, what's been published actually is really looked at only the water-soluble for same-day failed colonoscopy. I haven't seen literature on using barium for same day. I think it's also important to remember when you administer the water-soluble contrast in these failed colonoscopy cases that you wait until the patient is fully awake and alert from sedation from the colonoscopy.
Absolutely.
Which can take, you know, an hour or several hours, actually, but just to prevent aspiration. Okay, and for decubitus imaging, do you use bilateral decubitus imaging for large patients ever?
No, we do not routinely ever tell the patient, the tech, to scan three times. We want to keep that radiation dose low. We tailor it to what we see. So it's the quality assurance of the scan. What we do after the first two scans are done, the supine and the decubitus, and we make the decision. We have about 5% of the time maybe use a third scan. So,
but let me clarify. There are some sites that will actually use, you know, the two opposing bilateral decubitus scans. So it would be two scans still. So you're skipping supine, you're skipping prone, and you're just doing the bilateral decubes for the large BMI patients. Do you ever do that?
We have not.
You have not.
Okay. It's certainly an option. But,
okay, great. Thank you so much.
Thanks.
Okay.